अस्सलामुअलैकुम दोस्तों, उम्मीद करता हूँ कि आप लोग खैरियत से होंगे। दोस्तों आज मैं आपको डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक की बहुत बेहतरीन वीडियो दिखाने वाला हूँ कि एक बहन ने डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक से सवाल किया है कि मेरे हस्बैंड ने जो है मुझे तलाक दी है 3 बार, तो क्या ये तलाक जो है हो सकती है, अब हम रुजू कर सकते हैं कि नहीं कर सकते हैं, इसके बारे में हमें थोड़ा सा हल बताएं कि हम क्या करें। तो आइए दोस्तों डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक की वीडियो देखते हैं, इस बारे में क्या जवाब देते हैं।
The next question. I am Farhana from Dhaka. Assalamu alaikum, sir. Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If a husband says 3 talaq at a time, is it considered 1 talaq or 3 talaq according to Quran and Sunnah? Can the husband marry his divorced wife again? So please reply. It's very urgent. So your speech may save my life. Please reply. I am very helpless, sir. My husband showed your audio clip on talaq to the imam, but he said that was your earlier speech. At present, you are not delivering such speech. You are following madhab. There is another similar question. Assalamu alaikum. Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Manzoor Sheikh from Karachi, Pakistan, a businessman. Some muftis met you personally in Malaysia and after discussing with you, say that now you have stopped giving fatwas like before and only speak on comparative religion. Is it true? I'll first answer the question on talaq and then come to the second part of the question or the second question regarding what do the imams or the muftis say. The question posed by the sister is that if husband gives 3 talaq together, is it counted as 3 talaq or is it counted as 1? When you give 3 talaq together, there are 3 types of talaq that are prevalent in the Muslim society, and I've given this answer earlier in detail. I'll just mention in brief. There are 3 types of talaq prevalent in the Muslim society. 1, when a person gives 3 talaq together in one sitting, say talaq, 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 or say I've divorced you 3 times. I've given talaq 3 times. This is called as talaq-e-bidah, a talaq which is an innovation. The second type of talaq is talaq-e-hasan. A man gives divorce to his wife and waits for 1 month recycle, 1 menstrual cycle. Then after that, give the second talaq, then wait for second menstrual cycle, then give the talaq the 3rd time. This is called as talaq-e-hasan. That means a good type of talaq. And the 3rd type is talaq-e-ahsan. That is the best type of talaq as per the Quran and Sunnah. And a husband gives talaq to his wife and waits for 3 menstrual cycle, and after that, the talaq is complete. Now regarding the question that if a husband gives 3 talaq together, saying talaq, 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 or I have divorced you 3 times, is it counted as 1 talaq or it's counted as 3 talaq? This is the main question. And we know Quran gives the description in great detail from Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 228 to Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 232. And Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 228 that when you give divorce, you wait for 3 menstrual period. The idda period is for 3 menstrual period. And verse number 229 says that divorce is only permissible twice. The 3rd time you give, it's irrevocable. That means you cannot do ruju after that. And verse number 30 says, 230, sorry, Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 230 says that if you give irrevocable divorce, that means if you give talaq 3 times, then you cannot marry the husband. Same, you have to marry another person, and if that person gives talaq, then you can marry the former husband. So now there are 3 types of talaq, as I mentioned, prevalent in the Muslim society. Regarding the 1st type of talaq, that if you give talaq together in one sitting, talaq, 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 or say I've given talaq 3 times together, is it counted as 1 or counted as 3 talaq? According to all the 4 aimas, the fatwas of all the four Imams, Imam, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, according to Imam Shafi, Imam Malik, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, all four schools of thought, they say that if three talaqs are given at one time, or if triple talaq is said three times together, it is counted as three talaq and it is irrevocable. So as far as the fatwa of the four imams are concerned, there is an ijma in the four imams. All the four schools of thought, the Hanafi school of thought, the Maliki school of thought, the Shafi school of thought, and the Hanbali school of thought, all four schools of thought, they unanimously agree that if a husband in Islam gives three divorces together, saying talaq, 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 or I divorce you three times, it is counted as three talaq and it is irrevocable. That's ijma. And when you ask the scholars of these four madhahib, and they give the reply that they say that if it is not correct to kill an innocent human being, to shoot with a gun, innocent human being is prohibited. But if someone shoots, the person dies. You know, so many of the Maulanas in India, Pakistan, they give this logic that goli marna masoom ko haram hai. Lekin goli mare to insan mar jata hai. So killing an innocent person is prohibited in Islam. But if you shoot at an innocent person, he will die. The same way, giving triple talaq is prohibited. You should not give. It's not correct. But if you give, divorce takes place. And it's irrevocable. So my argument with this answer is that Maulana, we are not asking you whether killing innocent human being is allowed or not. We know it's haram. We are asking you that if you shoot, and if the bullet inside is true or fake, if it's a bullet which is true, the person will die. If it's a fake bullet, the person will not die. So our question is the bullet fake or true? So when we say giving triple talaq, is it the correct method according to Quran, Sunnah or not? We know that giving triple talaq together is wrong. But if you give triple talaq, does it constitute three talaq or one talaq? So if you shoot someone, the bullet in the gun, is it authentic or is it fake? If it's a fake, you'd only hear a loud voice, but no one will die. It is a dummy bullet. Coming to the argument. So all the four madhahib unanimously, they agree that if you give triple talaq in one sitting, it is counted as one. But according to many scholars, according to Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, and even according to Shaykh As-Sadi, they say that though all the four a'imma say that triple talaq is counted as three, they say no, according to the authentic ruling, the more correct ruling is, it is counted as one. And for the evidence, they quote hadith from Sahih Muslim. And they say, if you read Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 3763. It says in this hadith that Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that during the times of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and Abu Bakr, and 2 years of the caliphate of Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, three divorces were counted as one. But then Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, said that people are doing haste in a thing in which they should take time. I will make them binding and make them accept it. So this hadith, which is a mawquf hadith, it's a saying of Ibn Abbas. So it's a mawquf hadith. There are actually four types of hadith. If the hadith reaches to the narrators and it goes the Sahaba, Sahaba says, the Prophet said, and Prophet said, Allah says, that is the highest level, Hadith-e Qudsi. The second is Marfu Hadith, the narrators go, it goes to the Sahaba, Sahaba said, the Prophet said it, that's a Marfu Hadith. Then comes the Mawquf Hadith, it goes to the Sahaba, that the Sahaba said it. The Tabi'in says Sahaba said it, the chain is correct. It's a Mawquf. And there's a last category called as Maqtu, means disconnected, it goes till the Tabi'in. So what the Tabi'in says, it is the fourth category Hadith. So this is a Mawquf Hadith, it's the call of Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him. It's in Sahih Muslim, and Sahih Muslim, all the Hadith is authentic. Volume number 4, Hadith number 7, Hadith number 3763, that Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, said that during the period of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and Abu Bakr, and 2 years of Umar's caliphate, triple talaq was counted as one. But then Umar said, people are making haste in a thing which they should do, they should take time in it. I will make it binding on them. What they say, I will make it binding on them and make them adhere to it. The next hadith of Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 3764 says that Ibn Taus narrated from his father that Abu As-Sahaba said to Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, that is it not true that during the time of the Prophet and at the time of Abu Bakr and 3 years of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, three talaq was counted as one? And Ibn Abbas replied, yes, may Allah be pleased with him. There's another hadith, next hadith of Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 3765, which says that Ibn Taus, may Allah be pleased with him, said that Abu As-Sahaba said that the Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, can you give us some information which is unique? And is it not true that during the time of the Prophet and Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, three divorces were counting as one? He said, yes. But later on, Umar, he said that people were making haste in giving divorce, so I will make it binding on them, whatever they say. That means at the time of Umar, Umar said that three talaq will be counted as three and not as one, I'll make it binding on them. So, according to Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, according to Sheikh Ibn Qayyim, according to Sheikh As-Sadi, and there are many scholars, they say that the view of the majority of the Sahabas, like Ibn Abbas, Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, Abdurrahman bin Auf, the majority of the Sahabas, they believed in the view that triple talaq was counted as one talaq. And they say that there's also a hadith in Musnad Ahmad with a Jayyid Isnad, which is with a Sahih chain, where Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that Ar-Ranaq, one of the Sahabas, he divorced his wife three times and then he regretted and he came to the Prophet. So the Prophet said, this three divorce is counted as one, you can do ruju. So there's a clear-cut hadith at the time of the Prophet, it is a Sahih hadith in Muslim Ahmad, that the Prophet, when one Sahaba gave his wife divorce three times and the person regretted, he came back to the Prophet and Prophet said, it is counted as one divorce, you can do ruju. So based on these evidences, according to many scholars, but naturally, the four schools of thought, all of the four schools of thought, all the Ahmas and the scholars, almost all of these four schools of thought, they agree that triple talaq, if given in one sitting, is counted as three separate talaq. But according to Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, according to Ibn Qayyum, according to Shaykh As-Sadi, according to Shaykh Muhammad Saleh Al-Utaymi, all of these scholars, according to Shaykh Nasruddin Albani, according to Shaykh Abdullah Ibn Jibreen, all of them say that triple talaq giving in one sitting is counted as one talaq, and this is the opinion of Ibn Abbas and most of the majority of the Sahabas, including the Tabain. And they quote Muhammad Ibn Ishaq or the Tabain. Even according to them, triple talaq was counted as one. When this question was asked to Sheikh bin Baz, that if triple talaq is given in one sitting, is it three talaq or is it one talaq? So he says that according to majority of the scholars, if triple talaq is given in one sitting, it is counted as triple talaq. But according to the Sahaba, then he quoted the same hadith of Ibn Abbas of Sahih Muslim, according to Ibn Abbas, triple talaq given in one sitting is counted as one talaq. So he personally, though he says that according to Ahmad ibn Hanbal, according to Hanbali fiqh, in Saudi Arabia they follow Hanbali fiqh, and he was a mufti, Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia. According to Hanbali fiqh, triple talaq in one sitting is counted as three talaq, but according to Quran and Sunnah, it is counted as one. So I personally agree and believe that the more correct opinion is given by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim, Shaykh al-Sadi, Shaykh Utaymin, Shaykh Abdullah ibn Jibreen, and Shaykh Nasr al-Dalbani, and Shaykh bin Baz. I agree with that view, because it's more closer to the Quran. Quran is very clear-cut, as I mentioned earlier, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 228, that when you give divorce, there should be 3 monthly period of waiting, idda. You can give divorce twice, but if you give 3 times, it's irrevocable. And the Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 230, that if an irrevocable divorce is given by the husband, he cannot take back his wife unless that woman marries somebody else and that husband divorces. But this should happen in the natural course. Today, we have many maulanas who say, no problem, we'll do halala. Halala means, no problem, you have given triple divorce together. Okay, not triple divorce, you cannot go back to your husband. No problem, I will do nikah with you. I will sleep with you one night. I'll divorce you. Then you can go and marry your former husband. This is haram. Planning such a halala, it is haram. You cannot plan that, okay, now you're given triple talaq. You cannot go back to your former husband. You want to go back, I'll sleep with you. I will have sex with you one night and then I'll give you divorce. This is nothing but, it is legal as prostitution. What the Quran says, under normal course of time, if you give triple divorce, then you cannot go back to your husband. And if you marry somebody else, and then under normal course, if there is divorce. And all this should happen according to the way the Quran says. And the Quran is very clear cut in Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse number 135 and onwards, that if there is a problem with husband and wife, you have to appoint an arbiter, one from the wife's side, one from the husband's side, and try and solve the problem. If you cannot, then is the question, divorce. And the procedure is given very clear cut, that the talaq ahsan, the talaq which is excellent, it you give divorce, and once you give divorce, it takes 3 monthly period for the divorce to get complete. During this time, if you do ruju, then you remain husband and wife, your one chance of talaq is over. But yet, you continue as your husband and wife. But if you don't continue, and maybe even a year has passed, and then if you decide, no, I've made a mistake, I want to remarry, you can remarry. Quran is very clear cut. In Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 232, that if you have divorced your wife, and after that, if the woman wants to marry their former husband, do not prevent them. That means once you have divorced your wife in the right way, giving one divorce, wait for 3 months to seal. And if they want to remarry, they can remarry, but since they no longer husband and wife, the 3 months period is over. Maybe they want to marry after 1 year or 2 years, then there is new nikah, new mahar, but you can remarry. That is second time. Again, if there's a problem, again, if you part, according to the right authentic way, give talaq, wait for 3 months to cycle. If you don't do ruju, after 3 months, you cease to be husband and wife. Yet after 2 years, you want to remarry, you can remarry. But second time is permitted. If you give the third time, then this irrevocable, you cannot take her back. because maximum you can give talaq 3 times. Then under normal circumstances, if you marry somebody else, and then if that new husband divorces, then if you want to return back, it's permitted. This is clearly mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Baqara, chapter number 2, verse number 230. So based on this, coming to the basic question, that if you give talaq in 3 sittings, if you give talaq in 1 sitting, talaq, 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 is it counted as 1 or 3? I agree more with the view of Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh bin Baz, Shaykh Nasir al-Bani, Shaykh Saadi, with this group, though they are in minority. I do agree that the majority, all the 4 madhab, they say that 3 is counted as 1. But I believe that as per the Quran and Sunnah, the opinion of Shaykh al-Islam, or you would say the opinion of the Ahl-e Hadith or the Salafi scholars, I agree with that. Now coming to the question. This was my reply, and I've given this answer earlier, maybe 10 years back or more, and my answer remains the same. Now coming to the first question, the lady says, when we showed my answer to an imam, the imam says, now Dr. Zakir Naik has changed and now is following a madhab. I have not changed, I'm the same. Of course, alhamdulillah, being in the field of comparative religion, in the field of dawah, in this few years, of course, my knowledge has increased, alhamdulillah, by Allah's grace. I keep on reading and meeting scholars and knowledge increasing. The second questioner, he posed from Pakistan, Mansoor Sheikh from Pakistan, that some muftis who met me say that now after Dr. Zakir Naik has gone to Malaysia, has done hijrah to Malaysia, he has stopped giving fatwas and now is concentrating only on comparative religion. I do agree that since I've shifted to Malaysia, alhamdulillah, I'm meeting multiple times number of more scholars. Because in India, there were limited scholars from all over the world coming. We used to invite these to come. But being in Malaysia, being the hub, alhamdulillah, whether it be English-speaking scholars from all over the world, I could say among the top leading English speakers, dais, maybe 10 may come once or twice in Malaysia every year. Then you have scholars from Pakistan coming here, you have scholars from Bangladesh coming, so you have English scholars, Bangladeshi scholars, Urdu scholars, and alhamdulillah, many of them come to meet me, and if I know that he is a scholar, or if I know he is a mufti, or if I know that he is a student of knowledge, and if I know the involvement of Dawah, irrespective, whether it's a Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Malki, whether it's a Salafi, whether it's Jamaat-e-Islami, whether it's a Tablighi, I welcome them all with open hearts. I respect a Dai. I respect a student of knowledge. I respect a person who is a Sheikh. I respect a Maulana. I respect a Mufti. I love all. Unless if the deviated sect, you know, maybe Shia or a Qadiani, that's different. But if he's from Ahle Sunnah wal Jamaat, whether Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Malki, whether Jamaat Islami, whether he's Ahle Hadith, whether he's a Tablighi, and I have scholars and duats and students of knowledge from various different groups, from various different countries, and I welcome them all. And when I meet these, and the question is correct, there are tens of mufti from India, from Pakistan, from America, from UK, from Bangladesh, they regularly, every year they come and meet me. Maybe Allah has put love in their hearts. Some of them I know, some of them I'm meeting the first time, some I don't know at all, some they say very popular, I go on the YouTube and I see, oh mashallah, he has millions of followers. I never knew of them. When I meet them, I respect them, I respect their view, and I'm a good host to them. Regarding the first question, and regarding the second question, after Dr. Zakir Naik has shifted to Malaysia, he has changed, he has stopped giving fatwas, he is concentrating on Islam and comparative religion. Let me tell you very clearly, never in my life have ever given fatwa on my own. Never. I'm a Dai. I'm not a Mufti. I'm not an expert, or you could say that I don't call myself a person who's qualified to give individual fatwas. What I'm a Dai. A prophet said, "Ballego anni wala aya." Propagate even if to be one verse. What I do my research and I analyze the fatwas given by various different scholars. I'm specialized in Islam and comparative religion. I don't consider myself to be a scholar in fiqh, but I do consider myself to be a student of knowledge. And I do analyze. Now, what is the difference between when I was in India and when I did hijrah to Malaysia? There's a great difference and I agree with that. When I was in India, I used to give a lot of public lectures. And most of my lectures used to concentrate on non-Muslims. And secondly, on the educated Muslims, trying to get them closer to Islam. And those less practicing Muslims getting closer to Islam. So most of my public lectures that you see, you could say on average, 60% of my topics were focused exclusively for non-Muslims. And out of this, majority, maybe 50% of my lectures were Islam and comparative religion. For example, similarities between Islam and Christianity, similarities between Islam and Hinduism, concept of God in Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the major world religious scriptures, religion in the right perspective, universal brotherhood. All these are hardcore lectures exclusively for non-Muslims talking about comparative religion, quoting the Bible, quoting the Vedas, quoting the Upanishad, quoting the Jewish scriptures, and that is my specialty. So 60% of my lectures were exclusively targeted only for non-Muslims, out of which half of my lectures were exclusive lectures on Islam and comparative religion. Quoting, besides quoting the Quran and the Hadith, quoting the Bible, quoting the Vedas, quoting the Upanishad, quoting the Manusmriti, quoting Dhammapad, quoting the Zadavesta, so on and so forth. And 10% of the lectures exclusively for non-Muslims may not be on comparative religion. For example, is terrorism a Muslim monopoly? Concentrating on the non-Muslims, it may have very little of comparative religion, but it is talking to the non-Muslims. Such topics are there. So 60% of my talks were exclusively on comparative religion, mainly targeting exclusively the non-Muslim. But when I'm talking to the non-Muslim, my audience majority is Muslim. On average, 25% of my audience are non-Muslims, 75% are Muslims. When the Muslims are hearing my talk, even the talks which are exclusively meant for non-Muslims, they are getting guidance, they are getting knowledge how to do dawah to a non-Muslim, which is one of the faraid of a Muslim. It is fard on every Muslim to do dawah. For you to go to Jannah according to Surah Al-Asr, one of the criteria is you should do dawah. Besides doing the other faraid, dawah is a fard. According to Surah Al-Asr, if you don't do dawah under normal circumstances, you should not enter Jannah. So the Muslims who hear my talk, number one, they get educated how to do dawah with a Christian, with a Hindu, with atheist. So some of my lectures are focused to atheists. Like is the Quran God's word. Comparatively, they say how to prove logically to an atheist the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So 60% of my lectures, though they were targeted only for non-Muslims, even the Muslims benefited. And it is unique. There are few duats like Sheikh Didat and very few who talk about comparative religion. Even today, you have thousands of English duat, but only a handful who speak on comparative religion. Only a handful. Sheikh Didat was number one. And after Sheikh Didat has gone, you hardly have any da'is who speak on comparative religion. So this was my specialty. The remaining 30% of my talk was talking about the aspects of Islam logically, which was meant for the Muslims and non-Muslims together. For example, Quran and modern science. When I speak about Quran and modern science, it is even inspiring a non-Muslim. MashaAllah, Islam is a modern religion. It talks about science and technology, many things which scientists did not know. They came to know 200 years back, 300 years back. Quran is mentioned 14 years ago. So it inspires a Muslim to come closer to Islam. It even inspires a normal Muslim. MashaAllah, my religion is scientific. It's up to date. So 30% of my lecture were talking about Islamic aspects with reason, logic, science, like Quran, modern science, like women's rights in Islam. So all these topics are topics which are generic topics, which is meant for Muslims and for non-Muslims, both. Talking about reason, logic, and science. This is about 30% of my talk. The remaining 10% of my talk was exclusively meant for Muslims. So 90% of my talk was meant actually for non-Muslims, 60% exclusively for non-Muslims, but even the Muslims benefited, 30% both for Muslims and non-Muslims, both, like Quran, modern science, women's in Islam, terrorism, an Islamic perspective, and various other talks. 10% were exclusively for Muslims only. For example, Al-Quran, should it be read with understanding? Or Dawah and Destruction? Or if the label shows your intent, wear it. So these talks, about 10% of my topics, were exclusively only for Muslims. So my major talks were exclusively for non-Muslims. The 60%, which even the Muslims benefited, 30% were targeting both Muslims and non-Muslims. So 90% of my talks were for non-Muslims and for Muslims both. And out of which 50% was the Islam and compatible religion, and 10% were exclusively for Muslims. Now, after every talk, public talk of mine, I have to have open question answer session. So in this question answer session also, the percentage of questions coming was somewhat similar. 50% questions were dealing with Islam and comparative religion. 90% of the questions were from non-Muslims, of which 50% were comparative religion. Other were on how to prove to an atheist about various aspects, you know, and even Muslims used to ask questions on the logical aspects of Islam, 30%. So 30% which was meant on logic, even Muslims asked, even non-Muslims asked. There was 10% of my questions which were dealing with issues of fiqh. But out of this, 99% were general issues. For example, riba, is that allowed or not? I gave a talk on interest-free economy promulgated by the Quran. There's no difference of opinion, it is fiqh. But no difference of opinion. Alcohol is haram. I've given the answer. No difference of opinion. So 10% was on fiqh. But someone said alcohol haram. I said yes. And I have to give various reasons. So from this 10%, 90% of them, or 99% of it, was not comparative fiqh. It was fiqh. Pork is haram. Alcohol is haram. I have to give answer with reason logic. So the Muslim was happy. It was dealing only with Muslim. What to do? 1% from all my questions, less than 1%, or 1% of 10%, that's 0.1%, were dealing with comparative fiqh. And I hardly can quote four or five questions. One of them is triple talaq counted as one or three? And I gave this answer many years back, maybe 15 years back, 20 years back, or before that, that no triple talaq is one talaq. This is comparative fiqh. If you ask me, how many questions on comparative fiqh have I answered before I came to Malaysia, you can count them on your fingertips. Two, three, maybe if a woman touches a man, does the wudu break or not? Hanafi school of thought says it breaks, Shafi school of thought says it doesn't break. And there's a difference of opinion. And I believe more with Hanafi school of thought that the wudu breaks. And I give my reason. So one is triple talaq, one is does the wudu break or not? Hardly anything else. Two, three, if I think I'll get three, four. So other things on fiqh, no one had problem. Alcohol is haram, Hanafi says, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, all say, interest is haram, everyone says, pork is haram, everyone says, it is fiqh. But general knowledge, there's no difference of opinion. So even in the question of fiqh, it was mainly fiqh, which no one disagreed with. There were few questions, Taraweeh, is it 8 rakat or 20 rakat? I was of the opinion 8 rakat is more correct, but even 20 you read, no problem. So hardly I can think of three, four questions. Now, when I did Hijra to Malaysia, those people who say that Dr. Zakir Naik has stopped giving fatwas, first of all, I never gave fatwas. Whatever I said was of the opinion of the scholars. And I would agree more and say this, I agree more authentic than the other. There was nothing except for three, four questions. But these three, four answers became so popular, especially on talaq, that those who believe in sticking to a madhab, they started getting, you know, oh, why Dr. Zakir Naik giving fatwas? And how many fatwas I give in? Which fatwas have I said which are wrong? And they can hardly quote any. But when I came to Malaysia, but naturally, and I told that earlier, that the times changed, and My dawah changed a lot. And one thing good that happened because of pandemic. In India, I never used to give online. Maybe 1 or 2 months, there was a talk in Pakistan. Once or twice, a short talk of half an hour I've given online. Once or twice, that's in my full life. When I came to Malaysia, I continued with that. I have to give lectures. But when pandemic came, I did hijrah to Malaysia in 2016 or 17. After you lectures, I went to Indonesia, Turkey, I gave lectures to continue. In 2018-19, I gave various lectures. I gave a large lecture in, mashallah, Atlanta, more than 100,000 people came. In 2020, the pandemic came and all the public lectures were stopped. Inside Malaysia, outside Malaysia, I could not travel for 2 years. Then, I being a dai, what to do? We went online. And when we went online, we started this Ask Dr. Zakir. I remember the first time I came online was in 2020, in the month of Ramadan. It was, I think, April. And I used to handle twice a week, Tuesday and Saturday, for 1.5 hour. And then I realized when I used to handle twice a week, I have to prepare, it takes about 1 day to select. Choosing the question, a lot of time, you know, or twice a week is too much, then I made it once a week. So after Ramadan got over, for 1 month I handled for twice a week. When Ramadan got over, I continued every Saturday, asked Dr. Zakir. After a few months, my son started joining me from Saudi Arabia. He was doing his bachelor's. So I used to handle for 1.5 hour, he used to handle for 1/2 hour, we used to have for 2 hours. Then in 2021, after 1 year of me starting this program, he finished his bachelor's in 2020, and 2021 March, he came to Malaysia. When he came to Malaysia, then we split every first and third Saturday I used to handle in the program Ask Dr. Zakir. Every second and fourth Saturday, my son Farik used to handle the program Ask Sheikh Farik. Now he was a bachelor in Sharia, now he's doing his master's. He finished more than 2 years of his master's, he's in final year of his master's in Sharia, that is Fiqh and Usul al-Fiqh, from the Islamic University of Malaysia. He passed from Jamiat al-Imam, which is one of the best universities in the world, which was, he did about 1 year Mahad, then an additional 1 year, 2 years, then 4.5 years of his bachelor's, totally spent about 6.5 years in Saudi, and he came here. I wanted him to be closer to me, so that he learns the practical aspects of Dawah. What your university is more of theory. So when he handled for 1 hour, every fourth, every second and fourth Saturday. I started handling every first and third Saturday of every month. And I used to handle for 2 hours. I say 2 hours, but goes for 2 hours, 10 minutes, 2 hours, 15 minutes. Now also, mashallah, more than 2 hours that we have started the program. And it's better to take longer session twice a week so I can continue with other activities. Now, there's a world of a difference between my question and answer session in all over the world before I did Hijrah. Because it was on comparative religion, the questions were open. Anyone could answer a question. Anyone could ask to me and I have to answer. We used to avoid chits. So 95% of my questions were open question and session. I don't know who to ask, what question, you make a queue. The only policy we had that non-Muslims were given first preference. So because non-Muslims were given first preference, majority of the questions on comparative religion, or it was answering logical to a non-Muslim. So most of the time, Muslims never had a chance to ask me questions. The Muslims were more in number in the audience, maybe 75%. But during question time, since non-Muslim had preference, majority times, or maybe more than 50% times, only non-Muslims asked. But as a policy, most of the time is to allow at least few Muslims to ask in hand, maybe 2 questions, 3 questions. Or sometimes if the audience, there are very few non-Muslims, then Muslims get more chance. So that's the reason. And we used to say that don't ask questions on fiqh. And even now we don't encourage questions on fiqh. But here, when we started this program, Ask Dr. Zakir, as you know, every week, only on WhatsApp, we receive more than 5,000 questions. 5 to 6 to 7 thousand. Then we receive several thousand on the Facebook. What we receive in the week, we don't count. Only live, we receive several thousand on the Facebook, several thousand on the YouTube, on the Instagram, all put together, we receive about 20,000 questions every week. Since on the Facebook, what live happens, there's a team who's reading and they forward on my mobile. I select an answer. But the WhatsApp is a more formal way of asking questions on this program. And every day they keep on asking. We keep on receiving. There's a team who reads. Normally, I don't think so. We read all the 5 or 7,000 questions we receive. My team may be reading half of them, sometimes 2,000, sometimes 3,000. From that 3,000, they select about 100 and they send it to me about one day before. I read those 100 and I select 10 or 15 which I should ask. And I've told them what questions I've already asked. Maybe I started handling open question session maybe from 1995 up to 2016. So maybe in more than 20 years of my life, I might have answered a few thousand, I might have given lectures of more than 2,000 or 2,500 lectures, public lectures, in which every question and session has about 10, 15, 20 questions, because the question and session normally is longer than the talk. So I've given 2,500 public lectures in 20 years, the question that may be asked may be 25, 30,000 questions. If you remove the duplicates, I don't know how many. Of course, there are many duplicates. So if I've answered about 25 to 30,000 questions in public, not one-to-one. So if you remove the duplicates, there may be 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, I don't know. Maybe 5,000. So majority of these questions, as I told you, 50% was purely on comparative religion. 30% was on logic only by the non-Muslim or Muslim, and 10% was on issues on fiqh, which was common. And 1% of this 10%, that means 0.1% of all the question, maybe on comparative fiqh. If you count, I cannot think of maybe three, I told you, maybe four or five, not more than that. When I came here, now, I don't want to give the same answers, why poke is haram, why alcohol is haram. I've given that many number of times. If a person asks the same question asked to me in a different program, I cannot say I don't want to answer. But if we ask the same question, same program, I can say I've already answered. So here I told my team, the question that I've answered, more than 25,000, maybe 5,000 on comparative religion, please don't send those questions back to me. They're already available on the internet, available on the YouTube, on the Facebook, on Alidaya, please. So they know if it's a question on comparative religion which I've already answered, they don't forward it to me. Only ask me those questions which have not been asked earlier. So, and which are worth answering. So they select, and with their logic or whatever it is, they forward to me 100 best. And from that 100 best, many a times, initially it was very good, you know, all were new. But I know already 2-3 years have passed, I mean, I've answered more than 1,000 questions. The first 2 years, it was very good. Up to 2020, from 2020 to 2021, 2022, for these 2 years, it was initially twice a week, then became once a week for 1 year, then became alternate week, but for 2 hours. So surely in these 2 years, I might have answered more than 1,000 questions. Each time answer about 15 on average, sometimes 10, sometimes 20, sometimes 25, sometimes 30, but average maybe 15 questions. So if you calculate all these, I've surely answered more than 1,000 questions in the first 2 years. In 2022, when the pandemic was removed and we could travel, now 50% of the time I'm in Malaysia. When I'm in Malaysia, I handle the question and session. So previously, maybe in the year 21, I might have had more than 52 sessions in a year. In the year 20 Ramzan to 21 Ramzan, more than 50 sessions in a year, every week I have to have. Then in 21 to 22, maybe I had about 25 to 30 sessions, because alternative week has to come. Then, 22 to 23, since half the time I was away, maybe in a year I'm handling now 12, maybe 13 or 15, you know, 12 to 13 sessions in a year. It's become less of 2 hours. Of course, all put together, there will be more than 1,000 questions that answered. Now, after I shifted here, I would say, the questions on comparative religion are approximately 15% only. Like today I spoke on non-veg comparative religion. I quoted. Only 15% on average. I'm not repeating. Maybe if too many people ask, I club it together. And few sessions before, I answered on why Islam allows a man to have more than one wife. The answer I've given earlier, but because there was a new thing, can you quote for me from the Bible where it says that Solomon had 700 had multiple wives, and Prophet Solomon multiple wives, Prophet Abraham, and then this was something new to it, so I had to give the full answer again. So 15% is on comparative religion. Now after, so from 50%, it has gone to 15%. Overall, yet today, 60% of my questions are targeted to non-Muslims only. But previously comparative was 50%, now it has become 15%. The balance 45% asked by non-Muslims, they are mainly on logic, asked by atheists. Now we find many atheists on the internet trying to misguide the Muslims, trying to create shubha from the Muslims. What I do, that those questions which have become popular, asked by the non-Muslims, against the Quran, against Islam, with reason and logic, trying to prove Islam is not a correct religion, not a correct deen, I'm picking up those questions and answering. Other people say, oh, this is shaitani sawal. So my specialty is non-Muslims. So these questions on comparative religion, again, as well, today in the world, I mean, in the English audience or the Urdu, there are hardly a handful of the people who are quoting comparative religion. Now coming to the question asked by non-Muslim, which is on logic only. For example, a non-Muslim will ask the question that you say that Allah has ilm-e ghaib. I said yes. So when Allah has knowledge, ilm-e ghaib, has all the knowledge, when you do dua, why should you do dua? Allah knows already what is there in your mind. So Allah should answer your prayer directly. That's a logical question. Most of the Shaykh will say, shaitani question, don't ask. Satan's question, don't reply, not worth reply. No, it's a logical question. That if Allah is ilm-e ghaib, you have knowledge, he knows what's in your mind. So why doing dua? Allah should directly answer your prayer. Why you have to do dua and then Allah answers your prayer? And I have given this answer earlier, maybe a year back. So these are questions dealing with logic. It has nothing to do with fiqh, nothing to do with sharia, nothing to do with the Quran. It is pure logic. So these questions, which are talking about Islam, and it is talking about purely logic. So 45% of my answers now are these questions asked by non-Muslim, attacking Quran, attacking Hadith, which has got to do with logic. Like how today the person said that if you are a non-vegetarian, if because the lion doesn't have teeth, you and the lion doesn't wear shorts or trousers, even you remove your trousers. It has nothing to do with fiqh. It's an illogical question. How do you reply? Okay, if you say that a non-vegetarian should not wear clothes because lion doesn't wear clothes, if this is your logic, then you're a vegetarian. The cow doesn't wear clothes. The goat doesn't wear clothes. You remove your trouser. No, this is nothing to do with sharia. Nothing to do with Quran. It is pure mantik. Pure logic. So this is my specialty. Answering to non-Muslims. And when I'm replying, the Muslims who are watching my answers on comparative religion, they are getting impressed with Islam. The non-Muslim, while I'm answering the non-Muslim, even the Muslim, mashallah, what a reply. We're turning the tables over. So yet my specialty is non-Muslim. But it has become less of comparative, has gone more on logic. Because today you go on the internet, they're attacking Quran, they're taking verse of the Quran. And what is this? What is that? Don't you see? Quran says this, Quran says that. It has nothing to do with fiqh. It is mainly how do you reply. So 45% is that. So 60% even today non-Muslim, but comparative has become less. And in the balance 40%, I would say 15% are questions which I answer to non-Muslims, which I answer to Muslims, which is not dealing with fiqh, but dealing with logic. For example, a Muslim may ask that if everything is mentioned in the taqdeer, Allah knows everything in taqdeer, and if I commit murder, Allah wrote down already in advance that I'm going to commit murder, so why am I to blame? Now this is logic, asked by a Muslim. Many Muslims feel scared to ask, sometimes asked by non-Muslim also. But basically it's a Muslim question. We believe in takdir. If Allah ordained my takdir, I'm going to rob. And if I rob, who's to blame? Allah, not me. If it's mentioned in takdir, I'm going to commit murder. And if I commit murder, Allah wrote it. Why am I to blame? So these types of questions, which are logical questions, nothing to do with fiqh, asked by non-Muslim, now constitute approximately 15%. So 15 plus 40 plus 15, 75%. So balance 25% of my questions today that I take is dealing with fiqh. Again, they may ask that, why does Islam, can I take a loan from the bank? Can I take scholarship in which I have to return back in installments with interest? Is it allowed? So from the 25% that is there of fiqh, 15% is unanimously agreed same. As I mean, interest, everyone says haram. Alcohol, everyone says haram. So is alcohol in medicine allowed or not? You know, these questions, or if I'm hungry, can I have pork or not, nothing to eat? So these questions on fiqh, where there's no difference of opinion, it's not dealing with comparative fiqh. The answer is the same by all the four emmas, all the five schools of thought, Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Salafi, what are you going to call? So out of 25% questions on fiqh, out of which maybe 15% or 20% is on general thing. Maybe 5 or 10% is on comparative fiqh, or maybe you could say 10% is on comparative fiqh. So 15% of the fiqh is unanimous agreement, all schools of thought. 10% of the question on comparative fiqh. So if you compare earlier, I used to handle maybe 1% on fiqh. Sorry, 10% on fiqh, and out of which 0.1% was comparative fiqh. Today I'm answering maybe 25% on fiqh, and maybe 10% is on comparative fiqh. From this 10%, comparative fiqh me differs. And when I give answers, believe me, I am not giving any fatwas. I see the view, what has been mentioned by Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi, Imam Malik, Imam Ibn Hanbal. I respect all these four Aimmas. I respect them all, and they were great scholars. They came to guide the Muslims. And I believe that if anyone follows any of these four Imams, whatever their view is, even if it may not be the authentic view, it will be accepted. I don't believe that all the Aimmas are barhaq, that all are infallible. No, they are fallible. But if a fatwa, because it's clear cut in Islam, that if a scholar gives a fatwa after doing research with sincerity, if it's the right fatwa, he gets 2 sawab. If he makes a mistake, yet he gets 1 sawab. So all these four scholars were great Aimmas. If anyone follows any of the view of any one of them, yet it's accepted in Islam. I'm not of the view that if it's not authentic, because these four scholars are great scholars. We love them, we respect them. If you follow any one of these four scholars, you are following Islam. There may be a view which is afzal, which is more correct opinion, or a view which may not be correct. So if someone gives an opinion and comes, so what you have to read, what type of a person are you? So what I would believe, and I said this earlier, previously there were two types of Muslim, a knowledgeable and ignorant, a mujtahid and non-mujtahid, two types. At the time of the Sahaba, then later on, either you know or you don't know. Are you a mujtahid or not mujtahid? Mujtahid has the right to do ijtihad and give khalas. As time went on, technology increased, so maybe about 50 years back, 100 years later, 200 years later, 300 years later, I would say there were four types of Muslims. One is a Muslim who was a namesake Muslim but not practicing Muslim. So if he does taqleed means following one madhab, whether it be Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, he's not even practicing, so no problem. Second is a person who is a practicing Muslim and he has knowledge about his madhab, but doesn't have knowledge of comparative fiqh, doesn't do much research. Second category. Third category is a student of knowledge. a person who goes to university, who goes to a college, Islamic college, does bachelor's in Sharia or Hadith or Tafsir, he's a student of knowledge, and the highest categories are the scholars. So previously, maybe 50 years back, there were four types of Muslims. Namesake Muslim, or a Muslim who is and not practicing. Second category, a practicing Muslim, has knowledge about his madhab, may not be aware of comparative fiqh, doesn't do much research. So these first two categories, if they follow any particular school of thought, any particular madhab and stick to it, that's what they should do. Because they don't have knowledge of comparative fiqh. The third category is a student of knowledge who's gone to a university, gone to a college, bachelor's of maybe Sharia, bachelor's of Tafsir, bachelor of Hadith. He is a student of knowledge. So he has a right, okay, fine, I will check what Abu Hanifa said, what Imam Shafi said, and he may agree, he may disagree. He's a student of knowledge. He has the right to agree or disagree. And the fourth category are scholars. They have the right to give fatwas. They can also choose, or they follow what they feel is right. So the first two categories do taqlid. Taqlid means agreeing or just blindly following. But there are two types of taqlid. One taqlid is that you follow the scholars because you don't have knowledge, you're blindly following. And second is, even if proof is shown to you that the scholar you're following is going against Quran and Sunnah, and yet you follow him, that is the real taqlid. Otherwise, following a scholar is good. But even after showing proof from Quran and Sunnah and Sahih Hadith, that see what the scholar has said is good, not matching with Quran and Sunnah, and yet you follow blindly, that is what is objectionable, not the other type. So coming back, today the times have changed. So today what I would do, I would classify the Muslim Ummah into six categories. There are yet some Muslims or namesake Muslims, may not be practicing Islam, may be doing many haram, they're namesake Muslims. Second category are good practicing Muslims, and they know basics of Islam, but are not involved in research, don't go on internet, they're happy with what they're doing, and they're following what the teacher has taught them, and they continue. The third category of Muslim may be those Muslims who go on the internet and try and find out, and they do more research, and they are doing research. The fourth category is those who, besides doing research, they are doing extensive research, and they are da'is. And they talk to non-Muslims, and they talk to Muslims, and they do Islam, and they interact, and they do more research, and they are doing a lot of research. Maybe they may have more knowledge than person who is doing bachelor's in Sharia. They may have more knowledge than people who are doing bachelor's of Tafsir, because they are spending more time. They may not have the degree. So this is the fourth category, who have not gone to a formal madrasa, but yet have so much knowledge, may have equal or even more, but may not have the formal education. Fourth category. Fifth category, student of knowledge, who's got a bachelor's or a master's or a PhD. According to me, one who has a PhD doesn't become a scholar, doesn't become a mujtahid, or doesn't become, he's a knowledgeable person. So I would call him a student of knowledge. So those of the da'is who come on Peace TV, most of them are students of knowledge. Maybe one or two maybe can come under the scholarly category, but most of them are students of knowledge. They may have bachelor's degree, they may have master's, they may not have master's, but they have done a lot of research, they may have PhD. And the last category are scholars. Today, the scholarly category are very few. According to me, handful, maybe a couple of hundred. If you ask me to name, I can name very few. So scholarly have become very less, unfortunately. So I would say that the first three categories, whose namesake Muslim, or a person who's good practicing Muslim but knows basics of Islam but not more, a third category goes on internet and does the research but is not a da'i, all these three should stick to a madhab. Whether Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, or you say Ahl-e Hadith, no, you stick to one. Now one who's going on the internet and doing research, whether Hadith is Sahih or not, okay, what does Hanafi school of thought say, what does Shafi school of thought say, he is yet not qualified to take a decision. So he can find out, okay, fine, I believe in this particular group, I want to follow this. You should follow one particular. You cannot keep on changing. Okay, I follow this fatwa and follow, no, this is wrong. One day you follow the school of Hanafi school of thought, one day Shafi, that is not correct. Because he is yet not qualified to make the decision what is right. But he can make a decision, okay, fine, I believe this is much better than that. So I follow this completely. Because previously, unless you don't go to a madrasa, you don't know what is right, what a school of thought says. So now, because the internet has become popular, it came in the late 90s. And you have social media now coming, you know, in 2006, 5. So now social media is more prevalent. Facebook is there, YouTube is there. So if you go on this social media, you can find out, okay, what you prefer. What is the usul of fiqh? Whether it is you believe in this school of thought, that school of thought, Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Salafi. Yes, you can choose. But yet you are not qualified to keep on changing from that by going, okay, what are the fatwas of the Hanafi school of thought? What are the fatwas of Shafi school of thought? Okay, fine. You choose one and stick to one. You are third category. You do research, but you are not qualified to say, okay, one, I will do this, once I'll follow this school of thought, then second school. No, you're not qualified. If you reach the fourth stage, where you have so much extensive research that is better than what you do in the madrasa or the university, then you can become close to the student of knowledge. So the fourth category, which has not gone to a madrasa, but is a dai, who has learned the basics, what is there required for fiqh or usul of fiqh, etc., with proper guidance, or who has not gone to university but has met many scholars and met. And then the fifth category, student of knowledge, who has a bachelor's or a master's or a PhD or has got the degree of mufti or alim, whatever it is, they come in the knowledge of student of knowledge. They come in the category of student of knowledge. They have the right, okay, this I believe in this scholar, this I believe in that scholar. So I consider myself to be a student of knowledge. And the last category of scholars are very few, hardly. Previously there were thousands, now you'll have a couple of hundred, that's it. And coming to the second question, that when muftis come and meet me, they tell me, Dr. Zakir, you know, you're doing great work, you're doing comparative religion, you have, you know, thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands have come to Islam, may Allah reward you, blah, blah, blah. But we have one suggestion. I said, what? Please don't give fatwas. I smiled. I said, so if I ask them that, if people ask me that, if drinking alcohol allowed or not, no, that you give answer. I said, why? No, this is normal. Okay, someone asked me, eating pork is allowed or not. What I say, the Quranic verse, then I'm, no, allowed or not, no problem. What they actually have problem is only with my two answers, whether triple talaq is counted as one or three, whether wudu breaks or not, two or three, not more than that. Then there are scholars who are great scholars, very good following. I don't want to take their name. They come and they meet me. They say, Dr. Saab, can we meet you alone? Yes, we go into a room. Oh, Dr. Saab, you're doing great work. May Allah reward you, blah, blah, blah. But don't feel bad, etc. You're doing such great work. But why are you giving fatwas? I said, what fatwas I'm giving? No, you should leave fiqh aside. That's not your speciality. Now, how does he know what's my speciality? Does he know my background? He's a great scholar. I love him. I smile. I said, Jazakallah for your advice. What am I going to do? I respect him. So I said, Jazakallah, Shaykh, may Allah reward you and all. I don't say that I'm going to follow your advice. Because what does he know? Unfortunately, he doesn't know that I've spent more time on comparative religion than medicine. He doesn't know I've spent more time on hadith and fiqh. He doesn't know that. I was born in a Shafi family. So my father was a Shafi from Konkan. There are about 20% Shafis in India. 80% Hanafi in Ahle Sunnah wal Jamaat. So what I learned as a kid, I was a good practicing Muslim, mashallah, average, 5 times salah, you know, fasting. I would learn that. Mainly Shafi. When I grew up, my father was well connected with most of the religious scholars of different schools of thought, with Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, yes, from the Saudi, and even Al Hadith. So I had to interact with a lot of scholars. And among the Hanafi fuqahas, the best I liked and the most intelligent according to me was Maulana Mujahid al-Qasmi. May Allah have mercy on him. He was wonderful. In my starting ages of Dawah, you know, maybe in the ending of the 90s, I started Dawah in the 90s, I used to meet him, and he was even the president of the Muslim personal law. And he was a great fuqaha. According to me, amongst any Indian that I would rate number one in Sharia, he was called as Qazi Mujahidul Islam Qazi. And he was excellent. And I learned a lot from him. A lot. So people don't know that, and I met many Hanafi scholars in India, Alim Nadvi, may Allah have mercy on him, and Maulana Parekh. I sat with them, I discussed with them, and many, many, many. And then, of course, when I started giving international lectures, and I met Ibn Ali Aziz, so I was mainly a Shafi, what my father was a Shafi, but he was broad-minded. So I interacted with many Shafi scholars, then with Hanafi scholars, then Ali Aziz scholars in India. Then I started going abroad. I went to Saudi Arabia. I met many scholars, many from Saudi Arabia. You want to call them Hanbali, you want to call them Ali Aziz. Then I met the Maliki scholars from Mauritania, all top. So Allah has blessed me that because of my dawah activities, my lectures became so popular that even though many of the Arabs don't know English, their students said, you should watch Dr. Zakir, and my lecture is getting translated. So when they saw my answers, they were very happy. So we discuss. So when I meet these top scholars, they ask me questions on comparative religion, I ask them questions on fiqh. So I studied hadith, and one of my first teachers was Sheikh Zahraman Azmin, originally Indian, and I had many, sat with him for weeks together, discussed about hadith. He was my first teacher in hadith. All top scholars, they were scholars. Then Fahd Rahim, Arabic language, and many. So I basically have not gone to any Darul Ulum, but by Allah's grace, I have sat with scholars of fiqh and hadith and tafsir and sharia. Sheikh Abdul Ibn Jibreen, I met Sheikh Bin Baz, some people I met Sheikh Bin Baz and spoke only once or twice. For few, some people I spent hours and days with together, some people months together, all these top people. So mashallah, Allah has blessed me that I met with a variety of people, Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Salafis, mashallah. Allah has blessed me, and today I've got contacts of most of these people who I meet. I can pick up the phone and call them. If there's a barrier of language, I have my son who can translate. If it's Arabic, some of them speak Arabic and English, both, few of them. Wonderful. But these people who come and meet me, whether it be from Pakistan, they don't know my background. So when I ask them, what is the problem? No, why are you giving fatwa? I said, Maulana Sahab, aapko problem mein mera answer triple talaq ke? Yes, uske upar. I said, will you say the same thing to the head of the Ahle Hadith in Pakistan? Will that top mufti, or I don't want to take his name, will you go and talk to the Ahle Hadith in Pakistan? Will you say to Maulana Sajid Mir or Sheikh Sajid Mir, that why do you say triple talaq is one? No. Why? And you come and tell me, oh, he's not your field. What do you know? What is my field? I'm a specialist of logic. I'm a specialist for the non-Muslims. I'm a specialist for comparative. Yes, that's my takhassus. But I've also studied hadith. I'm not a specialist. I'm a student of knowledge. So I have a right to choose which I believe is more on the haq. Never ever have I given any fatwa on my own, never. And from this 25%, as I told you, 15% are general, no one objection. In the 10% in which there is comparative fiqh, I have always given either the view of Hanafi or Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki or Salafi. 90% of the fatwas, they are common. In 10% where they differ, okay, I may agree more with the Salafi. Then maybe with the Shafi, then maybe with the Maliki or Hanafi, okay, fine. But I have a right to choose. All my fatwas are belonging to one of these schools of thought. There may be very few in which in my research, I may not agree with any of these four schools of thought, neither with the Salafi. There are one or two, very few. But there are some scholars, which are yet scholars from this group of. They are not my own fatwa, never. So there are maybe five or six questions that I've answered, maybe on masturbation, or maybe on very few things, which all the four schools of thought, including Salafi, say it's haram, and I may say it's makruh, I may have the reason, I may quote, then I've quoted the call of Ibn Abbas, I've Ibn Hazm, I've quoted Shawqani, I've quoted the present time among the Kubar Ulma, Sheikh Abdullah Mutlaq. So it is not an individual call. Yes, it is not the view of any school of thought. It is not the Jamhur view. It is a minority view. Now, lately, 2 weeks back, there was a Yemeni who had done PhD. And he came to know about my view on masturbation. He said, Dr. Zakir, you have said masturbation is makruh. No, it should be mubah. I say it is fard. I know that when I gave this answer, there were many people from Hanafi school of thought, from Shafi school of thought, from Salafi, who said Dr. Zakir is wrong, and I respect them. Because this is not the answer of any one of the schools of thought, neither Salafi school of thought. And even Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, Nasruddin Albani, Shaykh bin Baz, Shaykh al-Taymiyyah, all of them said it is haram. But I give my opinion, I say makruh. Why? It is a question on medical. And I'm a medical doctor, and the full answer is for 25 minutes. Then I give a rebuttal for 55 minutes. Both put together 120 minutes, which I don't want to repeat. But I'm going to tell you that it had all references in the new fatwa. It is by Ibn Hazm, who is mashallah muhaddis, a historian, a faqih, answer given by you know, he lived maybe more than 1,000 years. Then I gave this reply also given, I named the Sahabas, I gave the name of Tabain, then I gave Ibn Hazm, then I gave the name of Shawqani, was hardly 150 years back. Then I gave the present time who's living, Abdullah Mutlaq. He is from the Kubar Ulma. That means I'm not giving my own fatwa. It's a minority of the view, maybe very small minority. But these scholars are known scholars. And people say, oh, Dr. Zakir Naik, he should stick to medicine. Now one Salafi is telling that Zakir Naik, will he ever say this? Oh, Zakir Naik, you know, he doesn't know this, he doesn't know Arabic, he doesn't know that I have a lot of group in Bombay. At any given time, we had at least 30 to 40 alims from the Indian university, whether from Deoband, whether from Nadwa, 30 to 40 were muftis and alims and fazil. At any given time in organization, when we had more than 500 employees, we had at least 20 to 25 from the foreign university. Maybe bachelor's or master's or PhD in Madinah University or Jamatul Imam or maybe Al-Azhar. So these people are talking, don't know my background. That means at any given time, I had, mashallah, 40 to 50 students of knowledge, bachelor's, master's and PhDs, 20 to 25 from Madinah. I don't know of any Dawah organization in the world which had such a battery of bachelor's, master's, PhDs from Madinah University, from Jamiat al-Imam, from Al-Azhar, from Yemen University, from the Indian universities. So these people don't know, they only see me on the screen and they're talking. Okay, if you want to learn from me, I will help you. What? I will help him. We neglect these people are youngsters. They are young guys. They speak. They don't know my background. So before offering, they should know it is my background. That I've checked the answers. And today, these people who talk, do they have access to the top scholars? No. They read the books, but they cannot pick up a phone and ask them. Now, mashallah, today Allah has blessed that I've got the contacts of the top scholars. I can pick up a phone and ask them. Some of the scholars are behind bars. But they sat with them, hours together, days together, months together. I'm not just giving anything out of the blue. I never give fatwas on my own. Yes, I give the view of one of the schools of thought, or whether Hanafi, Shafi, Hanbali, Maliki or Salafi. And very few occasions it may not be the view of any of these. But yet, there are top scholars who have given this view. So what I want these people, when they come to meet me, I love them. I respect them. I have no problem. They may not agree with my view. But they come and tell me, oh, Dr. Zakir, it is not your specialty. You are in comparative religion. That same person who is talking to me, he writes a book on Islam and Christianity. Now, when I read that book, there are mistakes. Am I going to tell him not to write on Islam and comparative religion? No, let him write. If he makes one or two mistakes, does it mean I will tell him he's a scholar? Okay, if he writes on Islam and comparative religion, if he's done a study, and in the book he writes 100 points, out of which maybe 5 are wrong, will I tell him not to write? I may go and tell him, okay, these are Sheikh, it is by mistake, or no printer, devil, and correct. When I spoke to Didas, I have to talk to him also. I have to tell Sheikh Didas, can I put a point across? And he used to love it. Oh, Dr. Zakir, oh my son, you're excellent. Now these people come and tell me, your speciality is comparative religion. What do they know about my speciality? Yes, my speciality is comparative religion. If I tell them that the book you have written is wrong, why are you speaking on comparative religion? They feel hurt. So what they fail to realize, that the person who's in the field, other than telling me what they should in this answer is right or wrong. So when people objected to my answer on masturbation, I gave a counter reply of 55 minutes answering all the arguments. Again, with Quran and Hadith. I'm analyzed by many of my close friends who come on Peace TV. Most of them disagreed, no problem. But they disagreed with respect. Okay, this is the opinion of Bin Baz. We agree with that, no problem. Opinion of Asad Dalma, no problem. I disagreed with the opinion of Sheikh Uthaymeen, of Bin Baz, of Asad Dalbani, of Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyum. I respect all of them. These are my mean. But on one issue, I being a medical doctor, I having some information, I'm quoting. So what I have to realize that rather than discussing on the issue, coming and meeting me personally and then going and telling out in public, we told Dr. Zaki Naik, Dr. Zaki Naik will not speak. There was one person who came from Pakistan and we discussed on talaq. And I told them, yes, I'm aware that in Saudi Arabia, there are more than 400 fatwas which say triple talaq is counted as three. I was shocked. That doesn't mean I agree with that. So what my mind has broadened, that I may agree with a view which is more authentic, but if it's said by a great scholar and a Muslim follows, inshallah, Allah will accept it. This is the broad-mindedness. And people, when they talk about ikhtilaf, they normally give a very famous incidence of when the Prophet told the people going to Bani Qurayza. And they say that you see to it that you reach Bani Qurayza by Asr and pray Asr there. And we know that famous incidence, I'll just say it in short. And we know that some of the Sahabas, when they could not reach in time, they were late, they prayed before reaching Bani Qurayza. The other said, no, the Prophet said, you reach Bani Qurayza by Asr and pray Asr there. So some of them prayed before because they were late. They said, no, what the Prophet meant was really, we have to reach before there. But that doesn't mean that if we reach late, we should do qaza of the Asr Salah, because doing qaza is haram. So one group said they prayed, the other group said, no, we'll follow what the Prophet said, we'll pray there only. So in both the groups of Sahabas, they went to the Prophet and they told that one of them said, we wanted to reach, but we were delayed. But the time for Asr came, we didn't want to qaza. And we agreed that you wanted us to reach early. But that doesn't mean that if we reach late, we should not offer Asr. So we prayed Asr. The other group said, no, we followed the instruction, reach in Bani Qurayza and pray Asr. So even though the time for Asr came, we didn't pray, we followed you. So the Prophet said, both are right. Because what was the niyyah? Both of the niyyah was to follow the Prophet. Now one group misunderstood, or rather they thought that the Prayer said, pray in Bani Qurayza Asr, irrespective whether you are late or early. Others thought, no, what the Prayer wanted to tell us, that reach before Asr time and pray Asr there. But that doesn't mean that if you reach late, you don't pray Asr and pray Qaza in Bani Qurayza. That's not allowed in Islam. So when the Prayer said, okay, you understood that what I meant was pray in Bani Qurayza Asr, and you did not pray before even the time, you are right. What you thought? No, reach early. But if you reach late, you pray wherever you are. Both are right. Now, this is usul. So most of the people give this example and they say, the way you understand is right. But it doesn't stop there. What I'm asking, what did the Prophet actually mean? Today, what will I do? So if you misunderstand the Prophet, and you follow thinking what the Prophet said, and you follow that, inshallah, you are right, Allah will give reward. But my question is, what did the Prophet actually mean? So there are scholars who quoted other hadith and realized, and when they asked the Prophet, what they really meant was, of course, the Prophet had clearly said that doing qaza is haram. So what the Prophet actually meant was, he wanted the Sahabas to reach Bani Qurayza before Asr. But that does, and pray Asr there. That doesn't mean that if you are late, you don't pray, because not praying is haram in Islam. Unless if there are certain situations where someone is drowning and I'm going to save him, or the house is caught on fire and the Maghrib time is getting over, in this it is accepted. But this was not such a situation. So the scholars, what they say, what the Prophet actually meant was, he wanted the Sahabas to reach early in Bani Qurayza, but that does not mean that if they reach late, they should not offer Asr. This is the true verdict. So what the Prophet actually wanted was, he wanted them to reach early. But if they reach late, that does not mean they don't pray. So the Sahabas who prayed before reaching Bani Qurayza, Asr on time, are correct. But because the other group misunderstood, because they misunderstood and they followed that, even they, Allah will agree with them. But their understanding of the Prophet was wrong. So, in comparative fiqh, we have to go in detail. Just give this example and stop is not correct. So, if you misunderstand, thinking the Prophet said this, and you follow, that's the reason if our understanding is broad, and if one school of thought gives a fatwa, and you realize that my understanding of hadith is no, it is wrong, and they say it is right, then yes, correct, Allah will accept it. If it's wrong, they get one sawab. If it's right, they get two sawab. So meeting great scholars of different, as long as the niyyah is correct, so our vision becomes broader. So traveling after coming to Malaysia, mashallah, my whole, it has changed. Now we are meeting more number of shaykhs, more number of ulama from all over the world. We are meeting many Muslim politicians, many heads of states. We are discussing. So the life has changed. The impact has changed, mashallah. Allah has blessed that the Facebook has increased. Previously it was maybe 14 million, now it is 23.5 million. Previously the Facebook was 400,000 when I was in India. Now it is 3.6 million. The Instagram has reached more than him. So, alhamdulillah, this is Allah's blessing. We did hijrah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, these people who come to meet me, I love them. I respect them. I honor them when they come. But that doesn't mean everything what they say, I'm going to agree. So they come as a jazakallah for advice, that doesn't mean I'm going to follow it. So when they go back, they may have a misunderstanding, okay, Dr. Zakir Naik, no. Alhamdulillah, in these last few years, our knowledge has increased. And the more you know, the more you realize you don't know. And I said this earlier, the more you know, the more you realize we don't know. We know that we don't even have a knowledge of drop in the ocean. Our knowledge of Islam is less than drop in the ocean. The more you know, the more you realize you don't know. So, with this, we are just trying to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, serve Islam. I love the scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, whether they come from this school of thought or that school of thought, whether they come from this organization, whether it is Jamaat Islami, whether it be Tabligh Jamaat. We may agree with many things, we may disagree with something. That doesn't mean I love and I pray for all the shuk. So that has been my policy. So when someone comes and meets me, and if he says something, he may be right, he may be wrong. So this is my policy that alhamdulillah, after doing hijrah, we are meeting more of the scholars, more of the students of knowledge, more of the da'is from different parts of the world. Our interaction has increased, our vision has broadened, we have become more broad-minded, we have become more tolerant, we have become, you know, the unity of the Ummah is important. That is the reason my talk on unity of Muslim Ummah is much better now than what it was earlier. With this, I think we have spoken a lot. We have, instead of 2 hours, we have gone for 2 hours, 45 minutes. So this was the last question and the answer was long because it was on comparative fiqh and I had to answer the details. So please excuse me for that. With this question, we end this session. Until we meet next time, the next Saturday, inshallah, would be my son answering the session, Ask Sheikh Farik, that is on the 9th. Of September, 16th of September, 2 weeks from now, inshallah, I'll be handling Ask Dr. Zakir. And after that, since I'll be traveling, I have lecture tours, I'll be traveling for about 2 to 3 months. So for 2 to 3 months, this session or these programs will discontinue. So next Saturday will be my son Farik. Now he's in Indonesia, he's going to come after two days, inshallah. He was on a lecture tour to Indonesia and then a short vacation with his wife. He's going to come after 2 days, he'll handle on Friday, inshallah, he'll handle the next Saturday. And after 2 weeks after that, I will be handling. Till then, we meet on 16th of September. Wa akhir da'wan, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. अस्सलामु अलैकुम वरहमतुल्लाहि वबरकातुह।
जी दोस्तों, जैसे कि आप लोगों ने आज की वीडियो देखी है दोस्तों, उम्मीद करता हूँ कि वीडियो आपको पसंद भी आई होगी। जैसे कि डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक का जवाब आप लोगों ने सुना है दोस्तों, बहुत ही बेहतरीन जवाब था, बहुत ही खूबसूरत जवाब था इस बहन को। जैसे कि इसने कहा है कि मुझे हस्बैंड ने जो है वो तलाक दी है, तीन दफ़ा जो है उसने वो तलाक दी है, अब हम रुजू कर सकते हैं कि नहीं कर सकते हैं। तो बहुत बेहतरीन जवाब दिए हैं दोस्तों डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक ने कि तलाक के कुछ मुख्तलिफ किस्में होती हैं दोस्तों। एक तो तलाक अगर औरत पर अगर हैज की बीमारी अगर वो आ जाए, अगर हस्बैंड जो है पहले हैज आ जाए, पहले तलाक दे दे, फिर दूसरे हैज का वो इंतज़ार करे, फिर दूसरा जो है वो तलाक दे दे, अगर इन दोनों तलाकों में अगर मियाँ बीवी की कोई भी अंडरस्टैंडिंग हो सकती है, कम्प्रोमाइज़ हो सकती है, कोई भी सुलह हो सकती है, तो वो तो बहुत अच्छी बात है। लेकिन सही जो तलाक का जो तरीका वो यही है। लेकिन अगर दोस्तों इन दोनों जो हैज के दरमियान जो तलाक है इसमें कोई भी मियाँ बीवी का कोई भी फैसला नहीं हो सकता है, तो तब अगर हस्बैंड जो है वो तीसरे हैज के बाद अगर उसको तीसरे हैदार आ जाए, अगर उसको तीसरी बार जो है वो तलाक दे दे, तो इसके बाद जो मियाँ बीवी जो है वो रुजू नहीं कर सकते हैं दोस्तों। जैसे कि डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक ने बहुत बेहतरीन जवाब दिया कि हज़रत उमर रज़ियल्लाहु ताला अन्हु के दौर में ऐसा हुआ था, हज़रत मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम के दौर में ऐसा हुआ करता था। अगर कोई भी सहाबी अगर कोई भी मर्द जो है अगर वो अपनी बीवी को तीन बार तलाक दे देता, तो वो एक ही बार तलाक उसे उसको उसका समझा जाता था। लेकिन बाद में जो है ये तरीका जो है वे ख़त्म हो गए, बाद में जो है वो अगर एक तलाक दी जाए फिर उसके बाद भी कम्प्रोमाइज़ हो सकता है, मियाँ बीवी रुजू कर सकते हैं, दूसरी बार भी अगर तलाक दी जाए तो उसके बाद भी दोस्तों कम्प्रोमाइज़ हो सकती है, रुजू हो सकती है। लेकिन तीसरी बार अगर तलाक दी जाए तो फिर जो है वो रुजू नहीं हो सकती, फिर जो है बीवी ऐसे काम करेगी दोस्तों के बीवी जो है वो जो थर्ड पार्टी है उसके साथ वो शादी कर सकती है। लेकिन दोस्तों ऐसे नहीं है, जो कि आजकल जो लोगों ने ये किस्से बनाए होते हैं, लोगों ने ड्रामे बनाए होते हैं कि मियाँ बीवी अगर तलाक हो भी जाती है तो वो अगर थर्ड पर्सन से शादी कर लेती है, एक रात उसके साथ गुजार कर वो उसको तलाक देकर तो फिर अपने हस्बैंड से वो शादी कर सकती है, ये टोटली बिल्कुल इस्लाम में हराम है दोस्तों, ऐसे बिल्कुल भी नहीं होता। तो दोस्तों अभी इस बहन का अगर सवाल था कि जो मेरे हस्बैंड ने मुझे तलाक दी है, अब हम क्या कर सकते हैं, तो अगर तीन दफ़ा तलाक हो गई है तो अब कोई भी का जो है वो आप दोनों में रुजू नहीं हो सकता, अभी आप लोग अलग है। अगर आप अभी इस बीवी को इस बहन को चाहिए कि ये थर्ड पार्टी से जब शादी करेगी तो वो ऐसे नहीं करेगी कि वो कहेगा कि आप मेरे साथ जो है वो एक रात गुजारे पर मैं आपको तलाक दे दूँगा, फिर आप जो अपने फर्स्ट हस्बैंड के साथ शादी कर सकते हैं, रुजू कर सकते हैं, बिल्कुल भी ऐसे नहीं है। वो अगर नेचुरली अगर आप ज़िंदगी गुजार रहे हैं, नेचुरली अगर कोई ऐसे वाकयात आ गए, लड़ाई झगड़े हो गए, आप लोग एक दूसरे के साथ कम्प्रोमाइज़ नहीं कर सकते, तो तब तलाक का जो जरिया बन सकता है तब तलाक हो सकती है। लेकिन ऐसा नहीं हो सकता कि मैं वो जो है आपके साथ शादी कर लो, आप जो है एक दिन गुजारे दो दिन गुजारे वो तलाक हो जाए, ये बिल्कुल इस्लाम में दोस्तों हराम है। पहले ज़माने में ऐसा होता था कि हज़रत उमर रज़ी अल्लाह अन्हु के दौर में ऐसा होता था, अगर कोई भी हस्बैंड अगर बीवी को तीन दफ़ा तलाक दे भी देता तो हज़रत उमर रज़ी अल्लाह अन्हु कहते थे कि ये लोग ना समझ है, मैं इन पर पाबंदी लगाऊंगा और ये लोग जो है कम्प्रोमाइज़ करेंगे, सुलह करेंगे, एक दूसरे के साथ बैठ कर उनके जो प्रॉब्लम्स है वो घर में सॉल्व करेंगे, सब्र करेंगे, ये लोग जज्बाती लोग हैं। तो वही उस टाइम में जो है ये सिलसिला था और ये जो है इस तरह प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व हो सकते थे। लेकिन आज फिर बाद में जो ये जितने भी मसाइल पेश आए, अगर अब हस्बैंड जो है वो अगर बीवी को तीन बार तलाक दे दे तो दोबारा से रुजू नहीं होता दोस्तों, बिल्कुल भी रुजू नहीं होता। हाँ वो अलग बात है दोस्तों कि एक बार तलाक हो जाए तो फिर भी रुजू हो सकता है, दो बार तलाक हो जाए फिर भी रुजू हो सकता है, लेकिन तीसरी बार अगर हो जाए तो फिर नामुमकिन बात है। जैसे कि हज़रत मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम के पास कुछ असवाबी आए कि हमारे साथ कुछ ऐसा मसला पेश आया है, एक मर्द ने जो है अपनी बीवी को तीन तलाकें दे दी है, अभी वो रुजू करना चाहता है, तो हज़रत मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम ने कहा कि नहीं है, ये तीन तलाकें जो है वे एक तलाक के बराबर है। अभी वो हदीस है, जैसे कि आप लोगों ने दोस्तों डॉक्टर जाकिर नाइक की पूरी वीडियो सुनी है, पूरी वीडियो देख ली है, बहुत बेहतरीन जवाब दिए है उसने, हर एक जवाब का जो है कुछ ख़ास हदीसें भी बयान की है और फिर आयतें भी बयान की, आयतों की जो नंबर है वो भी बयान की है, बहुत बेहतरीन हर एक पॉइंट को उठाकर वो आप लोगों के सामने रखा है। तो बाद نے جو دوستوں یہ سلسلہ جو ہے یہ ختم ہو چکا تھا کہ کوئی بھی شخص اگر بیوی کو تین بار جو ہے وہ طلاق دے دے گا تو اس کے بعد جو ہے وہ رجوع نہیں ہو سکتا ہے. آج کل جتنے بھی پاکستان ہے اگر وہ جتنے بھی ممالک ہیں دوستوں مسلم ممالک کی میں بات کر رہا ہوں وہ یہی پرابلمس جو ہے یہی مسئلے جو ہے بہت زیادہ آج کل آ رہے ہیں کہ ہسبینڈ نے جو ہے وہ غصے میں آ کر جو ہے وہ طلاق دی ہے یا تین بار طلاق دی ہے یا ایک بار طلاق ہی یا دو بار طلاق دی ہے, تو ان مسئلوں سے جو ہے وہ بالکل بھی خبر نہیں ہے دوستوں. طلاق کے بھی اپنے اپنے کیا قسم ہوتے ہیں کہ کس طرح طلاق ہوتی ہے. کچھ طلاق ہے دوستوں, کچھ لوگ علم نہیں رکھتے ہیں, علم سے باخبر لوگ ہوتے ہیں, وہ صرف ایک بار وہ بیوی کو طلاق دے دیتے ہیں تو بیوی سمجھتی ہے کہ یہ میرے تین بار شاید کہ طلاق ہو گئی ہے اور وہ پھر الگ ہو جاتی ہے, پھر ان کی شادیاں ہو جاتی ہے. مجبور اگر وہ اپنے فیصلے پر پیشمان بھی ہو پیمان بھی ہو کہ ہمیں اپنے فیصلے جو واپس دیتے, لیکن علم سے ناواقف لوگ ہوتے ہیں, ان کو خبر نہیں ہوتی ہے کہ کیا ہو رہا ہے کیا نہیں ہو رہا. تو دوستو جیسے کہ ڈاکٹر ذاکر نائک کا جو بیان آپ لوگوں نے سنا ہے بہت بہترین بیان تھا, تو امید کرتا ہوں کہ دوستو اس طرح معلومات کی جو ویڈیوز ہیں ہمارے چینل پر موجود ہے, آپ ہمارے چینل کو لائک کریں سبسکرائب کریں تو انشاءاللہ اس طرح معلومات والی ویڈیو آپ کو ملے گی. اب جیسے کہ اس بہن کا سوال تھا, وہ کہتی ہے کہ میں بہت مشکل میں ہوں, ڈاکٹر ذاکر نائک سے کہا کہ آپ میرے جو سوال کا وہ جواب ہے آپ مجھے دے سکتے ہیں, شاید کہ میری زندگی وہ سنور جائے لیکن خوشیوں سے بھر جائے, غموں سے ننہال زندگی ہے میری اب جو طلاق ہو چکی ہے. تو ڈاکٹر ذاکر نائک نے جیسے کہ جواب دیا کہ اب تین بار طلاق ہو گئی ہے, آپ کا رجوع دوبارہ سے نہیں ہو سکتا. تو دوستو امید کرتا ہوں کہ اس ویڈیو سے آپ لوگ بھی اتفاق کریں گے. تو دوستو اگر کسی کے ذہن میں کوئی بھی کوئسچن ہو, اگر وہ اپنی قیمتی رائے دینا چاہتے ہیں تو وہ ہمارے ساتھ ضرور شیئر کر سکتے ہیں. والسلام.